All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life, I will trust in you alone.
To worship. It's great to see all of you this morning. Beautiful morning, beautiful place to be with beautiful people, so welcome. A lot of things are happening. If you haven't taken the time or a few seconds to look through your bulletin at all the things that are happening, we have a church-wide picnic this evening down in our lower parking lot at 5 p.m. It's sort of geared towards student ministry, but everybody's welcome, so I hope you can join us. All the information is there. I guess you need to bring your own chair and a side dish. So see that announcement. If you haven't taken our spiritual service interest and experience survey, a number of you have, there's a link on our website where you can take it. There's one in the bulletin. I think we sent one out in the e-news at least a couple weeks ago. I didn't see the e-news this week. But yeah, it takes about literally 2 minutes. There's just 15 areas of ministry we're looking for as we prepare and plan for the fall. So if you haven't taken that survey, we would appreciate it if you did. Other things are happening, so please check them out. If you're with us as a guest, there are guest information cards in that card holder in front of you. We'd love a way of keeping in contact with you. You can drop the card in the offering plate back on the table as you enter. Hand it to me afterwards. I'd love to meet you. But welcome if you're visiting as a guest. There are prayer request cards in that card holder as well. We'd love to pray with you and for you if you share your concern with us. We're going to continue our worship this morning with some verses from Psalm 27. I'm going to read them. Just hear these words from Psalm 27. When the wicked advance against me to devour me, my light and my salvation, whom shall I fear? Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. Gaze on the beauty of the Lord and seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. And my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. And his sacred tent I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and music to the Lord.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says of you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will see. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God, my Savior. And though my mother and father forsake me, the Lord receive me. So teach me your way, Lord. Lead me in a straight path because of my oppressors. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me, sprouting malicious accusations. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. So wait for the Lord. Be strong and take heart and wait for the Lord.
And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and forevermore. Sing his praise. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before.
continue, we're going to sing words from the 23rd Psalm, which is a fantastic psalm and song of hope, a song of deliverance, and a song of God's protection over each of us. So I encourage you, as we sing this together, to sing it as a prayer to God and reaching out to Him for His love. My shepherd, I shall not want. In green pastures, He makes me lie down. He restores my soul and leads me on for His name, for His great name. Surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days. And I will dwell in Your house forever and bless Your holy name. You prepare a table right before me, the presence of my enemy. The arrow flies and the terror of night is at my door. I trust You, Lord. Say, surely, surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days. Forever and bless Your holy name. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, You are on death. Oh, I will fear no evil. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, You are on my side.
Let's continue to worship together in our time of prayer as we reflect upon the words of King David and his prayer to God as well, Psalm 23. Oh God, we're so grateful and thankful that You are the Lord of our lives, and as we bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord this morning, we give thanks that You are with us in our moments of surrender, in our moments of joy, that we know that we are not alone. And as we strive to worship You and to live for You, we are grateful that You give us a place to rest, that we may come together to fellowship and to rest and to worship and to be restored, that You might give us refuge in our times of struggle, and that You are with us through the valley, and that You give us a seat at Your table, a table that has been prepared for us. So Lord, we know that You have our best intentions at Your heart, and we know that You have given us a place, that You have given us a purpose. And so may our posture of praise this morning be lifted towards You, and so that we might forever glorify Your name as we strive to live lives of worship, not just on a Sunday morning for an hour, but every day, in all that we do, that we know that we are not alone, that we have a community of faith, and that you are at the core. So God, restore us and prepare us to face the day as we continue to worship this morning. Amen.
Surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days, and I will dwell in your house forever and bless your holy name. Sing, surely goodness, surely goodness, surely mercy, right beside me all my days, and I will dwell in your house forever and bless your holy name and bless your holy name.
Thank you, praise band. Thank you, Tim, for that prayer. 10,000 reasons. I have 10,000 reasons, and I have 5 reasons. We just found out last weekend we're expecting a 5th grandchild, so we are happy and blessed. Yeah, so we're excited. February 1st, which my birthday is February 2nd, so... Just saying. Well, we're going to conclude our series we've been in for 6 weeks now. This is the 7th week. We've been looking at the life of David and trying to learn some practical lessons from the life of David. And so today's story actually comes from the early days of David's life. It isn't really recounted or told till the end of his life, when David is near death. But the story takes place when David is a young man. We know, if you've been with us, that David was anointed by the prophet Samuel to be the rightful king over Israel. He served in Samuel's court, Saul's court, King Saul's court. Saul was jealous. David had to flee for his life. And David made his sort of refuge, his headquarters, if you will, in the cave of Adullam. That's where he sort of hid as a fugitive of King Saul. And the cave of Adullam was about 12 miles outside of Bethlehem. Remember, Bethlehem was David's hometown area. I'm sure he was very, very familiar with. And at the time, Bethlehem, David's hometown, was under the control of the Philistines, the arch enemies of the people of Israel. And so it's a fascinating story in 2 Samuel chapter 23 about devotion and commitment on the part of 3 of David's mighty men, men who fought beside David. It's a story that I've always wanted to preach on. I've actually never preached on this text. It's just one of those stories, though, that's just sort of captivated me. It's not very long. And it's actually one of those stories in the Bible that almost sort of preaches itself. It's a powerful story that shows a lot about David's men and their devotion to him. I think it says a lot about David's heart, why God considered him a person after God's own heart. And as I said, it's found in 2 Samuel chapter 23. And I think it's a story about what it means to give our very best to God. So one of these 3 mighty warriors, mighty men, is a guy by the name of Josheb. Okay, the Bible says that he raised his spear against 800 Philistines and he killed them in one encounter. All right, like Samson, remember Samson killed 1,000 Philistines with the jawbone of a donkey. So Josheb killed 800 men with a spear. At one time, the Bible says, quite a feat. That's like superhero, Avenger, right? Captain America, Iron Man kind of stuff. Another one's name was Eleazar, and he was with David when they were surrounded by the Philistines. And it said he stood his ground and struck down the Philistines. And the Bible says that he struck down so many Philistines that his hand grew tired and literally froze to his sword. And so his hand literally cramped to the handle of his sword. He was swinging it so hard at so many Philistines. The third one was a guy named Shema, and we're not told how many Philistines that he killed, but it says that he stood in the middle of a field of lentils and defended it against the Philistines. All right, I guess he liked lentils, I don't know. But anyways, the exploits of these three mighty men, they just sort of, they boggle the mind. In fact, some of us might be just a teensy-weensy skeptical about their accomplishments. Maybe there's a little hyperbole, we think. I mean, how could one guy kill 800 men with a spear at one time? But twice in the description of these three mighty men, it says that the Lord brought about a great victory that day. It says that twice. So it was the Lord that gave these three mighty men the power to deliver their people. The Lord was at work in them and through them to bring about his mighty purposes for the establishment of David's kingdom on earth. And so let's pick up the story in 2 Samuel 23, beginning with verse 13. It says, during the harvest time, three of the 30 chief warriors came down to David at the cave of Adullam, while a band of Philistines was encamped in the valley of Rephaim. At the time, David was in the stronghold in the cave, and the Philistine garrison was in Bethlehem. So they were camped, the Philistine, the enemy army, was camped in Bethlehem, David's hometown. It was where he grew up. But the enemy had taken it over. Now, I can only imagine what that would feel like. All right, I love my hometown, right? I can't imagine what it would be like if one of my enemies were to come and take over my tiny little hometown in central Ohio. It's sort of like, imagine Columbus, all right? Or imagine the Ohio State campus being taken over by maize and blue, right? That would just be terrible. It's like, what's wrong with that? Or imagine if an opposing quarterback planted a team flag in the middle of an opponent's, right? And then ended up getting drafted by your favorite NFL team. It's like, ouch, right? That hurts. So I'm sure David was upset as well. But the story continues. David longed for water and said, oh, that someone would get me a drink of water from the well near the gate of Bethlehem. I mean, David's out in the desert, living in a cave, right? Drinking stale water from probably an animal skin or some kind of bag. And his mind starts wandering back to the water, the cool, fresh water from the well near where he grew up. I mean, think about that. It's like remembering something that you used to have, but you can't have it now, right? Like walking into your grandma's house and smelling fresh baked bread or fresh baked cookies, or sitting down at the table to a slice of fresh apple pie with a scoop of vanilla ice cream. You can't have it, but you can almost taste it. You wish you could go back and get it just one more time. But something stands in the way. Maybe it's time, maybe it's death. I mean, how much worse would it be if it were an enemy or someone you despise keeping you from what you want? So David is outside his hometown thinking about his childhood days and said, man, wouldn't it be great to have a cool drink of water from the well outside my hometown? And David is wishing out loud. And so three of David's soldiers overhear him, three of the mighty warriors. What they did is they broke through the Philistine lines, drew water from the well near the gate of Bethlehem, and they carried it back to David. Think about it. Now, I've had to go through some pretty tough situations to get gifts for someone in my lifetime. Nothing like that, though. I remember one time, it was near Christmas, Susan was leafing through a magazine. Back when they used to have those, they still have perfume ads in magazines, you could smell the perfume scratch or whatever. So it was one of those sort of, you could smell the perfume. And the name of the perfume was called Rapture. And at the time, there was only one store that carried the perfume Rapture. And it was Victoria's Secrets. Not a place that guys usually feel real comfortable going in to buy gifts, right? Okay? But I thought, if she wants it, I'll get it. So I put on my battle gear. I put a ball cap on. I pulled it down tight. I put on some sunglasses, a hoodie. No, I didn't put on a hoodie. That would be kind of weird. But I walked into Victoria's Secrets, down the aisles of all the female undergarments, and bought some Rapture perfume for Susan that Christmas. Immediately, I went to the closest sports bar, ordered a bunch of hot wings, and watched a football game to man up a little bit, right, after that. But my point is, these three guys loved their leader so much that they risked their lives. They were willing to sacrifice themselves for something other than themselves. I think it speaks volumes to them and their devotion to David. Not just the gift that they gave, but what they were willing to go through to get that gift. They broke through enemy lines, risked their lives to get a drink of water for someone else. I remember my mom telling us kids what it was like when she was growing up. My mom grew up in a single-parent home. When my mom was just a little girl, her father took his own life. And so she grew up in a single parent home. My grandmother never remarried until my mom and her older brother were married and had their own homes and families. But growing up, my mom used to talk about how they didn't have a lot of money. My grandma was a cook. She actually ran a restaurant. She leased a little place at the bottom of an old hotel, the first floor of a hotel. So they didn't have a lot of money. And then the Great Depression hit, and they went from being poor to being poorer. And my mom used to tell us kids about the time that they came and got their player piano. They repossessed their player piano because they couldn't afford to make payments. But my mom wasn't used to getting gifts for birthdays. No gifts for birthdays, meager gifts at Christmas. But every time she told this story about her older brother, my Uncle Pat, her eyes would just well up with tears because he did something remarkable at the age of 16. He dropped out of school so that he could help support and take over the responsibilities of the home. He took on any job that he could find, odd jobs around town, and for about a half a year, every spare moment of his life was spent working. And he saved up his money. And the reason he did it wasn't just to support his mother and his sister, my mom, but he saved up to buy my mom a new dress for her birthday and a new pair of shoes. And my mom, again, she would tear up when she would remember when my uncle would get home late at night, up early in the morning, off to work, just to buy her a birthday present. I guess my point is, friends, sometimes the effort behind the gift is bigger than the gift itself. And the effort made behind the gift sometimes makes the gift even greater. And these three men of David, they risked their lives to give David a gift, something that he wanted. His wish became their command. They loved David. They were devoted to him. But I want you to see what happens next. David had something that he always wanted, something that he thought maybe he would never have again. Three of his mighty warriors risked their lives to get it. But look what he does with the gift. So the three mighty warriors broke through the Philistine lines, drew water from the well near the gate of Bethlehem, carried it back to David, but he refused to drink it. Instead, he poured it out before the Lord. Far be it from me, Lord, to do this, he said. Is not is it not the blood of men who went at the risk of their lives and David wouldn't drink it. See, what he did in pouring that out, friends, it was an act of worship. You know, and the Bible talks about drink offerings, where you offer a drink offering to the Lord. And that's what David did. He took the thing that he valued most, the most costly possession that he had, a gift that came at the risk of others' lives, and he gave it to the Lord. He offered it to the Lord. And so it sort of begs the hard question, doesn't it? Would you be willing to do the same? Would you be willing to do the same? One of the measures of devotion is the commitment that we demonstrate and what we're prepared to do for someone or some cause to which we're devoted. Would you be willing to do the same? I want you to just dwell on that thought for a moment. What is the one thing that you want more than anything? Your heart's desire, the most valued thing that you own. And ask yourself, would you be willing to lay it all on the altar and say, Lord, I give it to you? Now, don't worry, I'm not going to ask anybody to do that, at least not today. But just ask yourself, could I do it? Would I do it? It's easier to be generous with the leftovers than it is to be generous to God with our best. One of our country's Medal of Honor winners, a guy by the name of John Hawke, he once said this, courage is not the absence of fear. Having no fear would be the absence of intelligence. Instead, bravery is overcoming that fear. And I think David's men demonstrated true bravery. David's men loved him enough to risk their lives to serve him and get him something that he wanted. Their devotion to their leader exceeded their fears of their greatest enemies. And so let me ask, what difference would it make when we let our actions be shaped and determined by courage rather than our fears? Fear holds us back. Fear prevents us from trying new things and taking risks. It whispers in our ear, if we try it and you fail, you're going to be embarrassed. But courage and devotion, they inspire us to be free to take risks and understand that the only way we go through life and never fail is to never try anything, which is never to engage in life. But by way of contrast, there's a magazine called Leadership Magazine. Years ago, they had a cartoon that poked fun at sort of the low level of commitment in many of our modern American churches. It depicted a church building. The caption says, "The Light Church." You can't read it, but it says, 25 fewer commitments, home of the 7.5% tithe, 15-minute sermons, 45-minute worship services. We only have 8 commandments, take your choice. We only have 4 spiritual laws, and we have an 800-year millennium. Everything you wanted in a church and less. Sad but true, isn't it? A friend of mine, a pastor, once said 90% of our churches across the country require less commitment than the local Kiwanis Club. Friends, down through the ages, whenever God has wanted to do significant work in this world, he's done it through committed, devoted people. God doesn't work through lukewarm people, but only through those who have a fervent love for Christ and his kingdom. And some of you are probably thinking, well, David was just crazy. He was just wasting that water. But he gave his best. He gave his best to God. Fast forward a few hundred years, we're sitting in a room belonging to a man named Simon the leper. A Jewish carpenter rabbi reclines at a table in his home when a woman named Mary comes to him carrying an alabaster jar of expensive perfume. The Bible says it's worth a year's wages. And she takes that jar of perfume and she breaks it, and the aroma fills the room, a beautiful smell. And she takes that perfume and she pours it on the feet of Jesus. And one of the disciples, I'll let you guess which one, he was upset. He was the one who took care of the finances for the little band of Jesus followers. He said, "What a waste of money. We could have sold it and given it to the poor." But Jesus said, "No, it wasn't a waste. In fact," he says, "every time my story is told, her story will also be told." Fast forward a couple more years, we're in a Roman prison. The Apostle Paul sits in prison because of the gospel, preaching that Jesus is Lord. He doesn't know whether it's going to cost him his life or not. And in that setting, he writes this, "But even if I'm being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, I am glad and rejoice with all of you." He says, "I'm glad. I rejoice." Again, a lot of people think that David wasted the water, that Paul's life was being wasted. Truth is, friends, when we pour out our lives like this, it's when we actually gain them. The other day I was getting out of my truck. I had a cup in the cup holder. It was from a stop at a drive-through window. I don't like leaving that kind of stuff in my truck. So I grabbed it and it was full of water, melted ice from the drink. I didn't want to drink it. And so I just poured it out in the grass. We've all done it. And I think some of you think that sort of being poured out, yeah, if it's something that you don't want, it's okay. And being poured out as a drink offering may sound unattractive, at least some of us who don't want to give up the pursuit of happiness, whatever that means. But friends, I think it should be pointed out that, you know what? We're all pouring our lives out for something. You can't live life without pouring out your life for something. For some, it's their jobs. For some, it's their hobbies or their recreation, whatever that is. Truth is, we all pour out our lives. And a life can be wasted like an unwanted drink. And so I guess the question is, what are you pouring out your life for? What are you expending your life for? Is it something temporary or is it something eternal? Something that lasts. So let me close with this. There's a missionary, former missionary, he's long gone, back in the last century, a gentleman by the name of C.T. Studd. Grew up in a house of privilege and affluence. His father made a fortune, and he was the heir to the fortune. He was a successful college student and a cricket player at Cambridge University. But one day, the great missionary to India, Hudson Taylor, came and visited and asked for students to become missionaries to China. And C.T. Studd and six of his classmates from Cambridge surrendered their lives. They became known as the Cambridge Seven. And Studd went to China, where he served for many years. When his father died and he had inherited all his father's fortune, he gave it all away. He gave it to missionaries, to other evangelistic causes. He had to return to England because of poor health. He recuperated, and then he went to back to India, and then he eventually went to Africa. And before his death, C.T. Studd wrote this poem. Two little lines I heard one day traveling along life's busy way, bringing conviction to my heart and from my mind would not depart. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Can you read those words with me? Let's read those together. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. I'm going to read the rest of the poem, and I want you to join me in that last line. Will you do that? Only one life, yes, only one. Soon it will be fleeting, hours be done. Then in that day, my Lord to meet and stand before his judgment seat. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, the still small voice pleads, gently pleads for a better choice, bidding me selfish aims to leave and to God's holy will to cleave. Only one life will soon be passed. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one. Now let me say, thy will be done. And when at last I hear the call, I know I'll say 'twas worth it all. Only one life will soon be passed. What's done for Christ will last. And he adds one extra half stanza that goes like this. And when I'm dying, happy will I be if the lamp of my life has burned out for thee. Friends, nothing you give to God, nothing you give to God is ever wasted, ever. Even a cup of water given in Christ's name is remembered. Every gift given in love is never remembered. Never wasted. And so I want you to imagine a scene in heaven. The angels are gathered round, and they're looking down upon this earth, and they see the Son of God hanging on a cross, his hands and his feet nailed in place, his body badly beaten and bruised, struggling for every gasp of breath. Do you think that one of the angels might have said, "What a waste. What a waste." But I can hear Jesus saying, "It's not a waste. It's a good thing." Friends, don't waste your life. Pour your life out as an offering to Christ. God, thank you again for the lives of people like David and his mighty men who give us just a glimpse of your kingdom and what commitment and devotion to your kingdom means. God, give us a heart of devotion. Give us a heart of commitment to serve you, not with just the leftovers, the extras, but the best, the very best, the first fruits. Friends, nothing we give to God is ever wasted. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I invite you to stand as we close out this morning and just pray that you can live your life for Him.
Times I failed, still your mercy remained. Should I stumble again, I'm caught in your grace. Everlasting, your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond your feet. In my heart and my soul, I hear will shine when all else fades. Never ending, your glory goes beyond the pain. My heart and my soul, Lord, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise
week. Doug Meek is going to be the preacher of the morning, so I look forward to listening to Doug on video, but have a great week, friends. The love, the grace, the mercy of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit go with you and abide with you always. Amen. Go in peace.
Mountain seems so high, and my faith too weak to climb. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I.